Christ, we shouldn't even be here. Stories, Mr. Farrell. The ones that really matter. Full of darkness and danger they were. And sometimes you didn't want to know the end. But how could the end be happy? How could the world go back to the way it was when so much bad happened? What the end? Only passing thing. The shadow. Even darkness must pass. A new day will come. And when the sun shines, it will shine out the clearer. Those are the stories that stayed with you. That meant something. Even if you were too small to understand why. But I think, Mr. Fogo, I do understand. I know now. Folk in those stories had lots of chances to turn it back, only they didn't. They kept going. Because they were holding on to something. What are we holding on to, Sam? There's some good this world, Mr. Farrell. And it's worth fighting.
Morning, everybody. I know, you let me preach for a few months and you guys are going to know the whole plot of Lord of the Rings off by heart. I can't help it, though. There are just so many applications, but yeah. Today I'm continuing a series that we started on Easter. We're a little mixed up right now because the snowstorm caused us to miss our last service, so I'm technically preaching week 3 on week 2, but it's a pretty open subject, this series, so we can kind of mix and match them. It's not going to really get us very confused at all. And the theme that we're talking about is hope. And today in particular, we're talking about having hope in the promises of God and the promises that God has made. And there are many promises that God has made. We actually, if we look through Scripture, we find a lot of different promises that are ours for the taking, that as believers, you know, we are privy to. And I thought I'd start by reading a list of some of the promises that you can find in Scripture. And so I'm just going to start with Isaiah 40:29. He will give strength to the weary and power to the weak. Isaiah 41:10, he upholds us with his righteous right hand. James 1:5, he will give us wisdom. James 4:7, if we submit to God, Satan will flee from us. 1 John 1:9, he will forgive us and purify us from all unrighteousness. Deuteronomy 31:8, he will never leave us or forsake us. John 3:16, there's the promise of everlasting life. Philippians 4:19, he will meet our needs. If you can hear a list like that and not feel the value that God places in you, then you weren't listening right. I think there's no better way to start a sermon than to just kind of say a list like that. That's just an amazing group of promises. Amen? Yeah, it's pretty cool. Yeah, and so those are some of the promises that God gives us, but there's also a personal element to the promises of God. There are promises, you know, that we find in Scripture that are available to all of us, and then there are also promises that God makes to us in our lives. Maybe, you know, these are things that we hope in. Maybe this is something that someone's prayed over you once in your life and you really felt, you know, in your spirit that that was true, and they said, you know, God's going to take care of this for you. God's going to help you through this. And that's a promise that you're holding on to. Sometimes when God calls us to something, you know, when he gives us a command, when he gives us a vocation or something that he wants us to accomplish, there's a promise implicit in that, you know, that if God's sending us somewhere, that he's got our back in some way. And it doesn't mean there won't be hard times, but it means that he will help you through. You know, maybe it's just something that, you know, you've prayed about, you've waited on God for a very long time, and you've felt God give you a peace in your heart, you know, over someone who isn't saved yet that you know, or someone who, you know, you really care for, and you felt God give you peace in that area. Now, I want to be careful. I'm not trying to be name it and claim it. I'm not saying, you know, pray for something and God will promise you and then you're going to get it. But what I'm saying is that God is our Heavenly Father and He cares about us and He loves us and He's walking through life with us. And one of the ways that that takes form is in promises that He makes us individually. And so there's a biblical aspect to promises, and there's also a very personal aspect to the promises that God gives us. I remember when I was in high school, and my wife and I, we were just dating, I had my friends over all the time to play video games. And we would bring all of our Xboxes and all of our cords and all of our controllers and everything like that. And it became ridiculous trying to figure out what belonged to who at the end. And so people started putting stickers or pieces of tape or whatever on their stuff. And you could always tell which Xbox was my wife's because she had a little sticker on the back of it, this tiny little white sticker, and it said, "God keeps His promises." God keeps His promises. It's a simple and profound thought. And the more that I've written this, and the more that I've talked it through and kind of practiced what I want to say today, the more I realize that that's the message of this talk today. That's what I want you to take out of here today, just that simple fact. And I mean, we're going to go about it the long way, and we're going to go through all kinds of theology and different thoughts and stuff like that. But what I want you to bear in mind throughout this entire talk is that God keeps His promises. God keeps His promises. Now, as we talk today, I'm going to be using two words kind of interchangeably. The word faith and hope I'm going to be throwing around a lot. And I'm using them to mean the same thing because when I talk about faith today, I'm talking about having faith in the promises that God makes us. Having faith in His promises. Now, the base definition of faith would probably be having trust or confidence in a person or thing. But faith is a big word in the church. We have a tendency to use it for a lot of different things. I know I'm really guilty of this one. I often refer to Christianity as the faith. I'll say, like, as we walk in our faith, we do this. Or, you know, as we live through our faith, we do this. So I kind of refer to our Christian journey as the faith. I've heard people talk about faith as just another word for belief. I've heard people say faith is the attribute of doing what's right. Faith is a word that we kind of stretch in the church. And it's not a bad thing. I mean, I think it's not an abuse of the word. When I use the word faith to mean our Christian journey, I'm 100% going to say our faith at some point in this talk. And I've like tried to train myself not to, but I'm going to do it because it's such a habit. So you can laugh at me if I do. But in our Christian journey, when I use the word faith for that, it's because I'm saying that we've placed our faith in Christ. And that works its way out in the way that we live our lives. And that is the core of what it means to be a Christian. Faith is a good word to cover a lot of meanings because it's a stretchy word. Okay, faith is a thing, if there's a seed of faith in a person, that will change a lot about their lives. It will change the person that they are. It will change the way that they act. Faith is something that can't help but affect the rest of the way that we live. That's what Jesus was talking about in Luke 6:44-45 when he says, each tree is recognized by its own fruit. And he's talking about people at this point. This is an analogy for how people work. He says, each tree is recognized by its own fruit. People do not pick figs from thorn bushes or grapes from briars. A good man brings forth good things out of the good stored up in his heart. And an evil man brings evil things out of the evil that's stored up in his heart. For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. Jesus is referring to this idea that, you know, our actions, the things that we do, they're not a result of what we eat. You know, they're not a result of the laws around us. It's not someone else's fault. It's not because someone told you so. It's not because you woke up grumpy this morning. What we do comes from our heart. It comes from our worldview and the person that we are. It comes from the things that are most important to us that remain there even when the life around us changes. And the easiest way to allow something, to bring something into that part of yourself, to that command center, if you will, of who you are, is by having faith in that thing. We talked, last time I spoke, I talked about lies, and I said, you know, when we lie frequently, we teach ourselves that lying works, and we kind of start to have faith in lies, and by extension, we become liars. Well, sure, it works that way, but it also works positively on the other end of things. Faith. When we open our heart in faith, we allow Christ in. It changes the dynamic of our relationship with Him. Can you go to the next slide, please? Oh, right. Okay. Yeah, I've heard it said again and again by Scott when he preaches that God's love language is faith. And that the love that he responds to most is faith. And this is absolutely true. If we look through Scripture, we see when someone acted in faith, Jesus got excited. We see God working through people who act faithfully in their lives. And God always gets excited about faith because it's his desire for us to open up in faith to him and let him come in to the center of who we are and be the thing through which we make all of our decisions. I remember when I was a kid, my parents talked to me about letting Jesus into my heart. And I was 6 years old at the time, so the image that I had was what any six-year-old would think of, which was a tiny bearded man living in my chest. And I had a lot of questions. You know, I was like, can we dress it up a little bit? Can we put a couch in there? You know, what can we do? He lives in heaven. Does he need more real estate that badly? It seemed like a strange thing. You know, and it didn't take long before I realized that, you know, that's not what was going on. There was something metaphorical happening. But it took a long time to really understand what we're talking about here. When we say we are letting Jesus into our heart, it's not just a nice feeling towards him. It's not just telling Jesus we love him or saying, Jesus, you'll always have a place in my heart. No, it's more than that. It's engaging in this journey and choosing to act in faith so that we open our heart up and allow Jesus to take that center seat in our lives. So if faith is the stuff that our Christian journey is made of, then what we need to do is we need to find a good example of faith in Scripture for our talk. We need to find somebody who can be an example for us. And today I want to talk about Abraham. And I want to talk about Abraham for a couple reasons. He was very special in Scripture. He had a covenant with God, his own, the Abrahamic covenant. He is the father of the nation of Israel in the sense that he's the person that they kind of trace their lineage back to. But also, when we read this verse, I want you to recognize that it's a little bit special in Scripture in the sense that it's a different kind of writing than we usually get. Because now it's still inspired. We still consider this to be the Word of God. This is Paul writing, you know, with the Holy Spirit's influence. But when Paul writes about Abraham here, he's not seeing this happen. He's not witnessing it and then writing Abraham's story. Paul is not having a vision and receiving that and then like writing down what he saw about Abraham. He's actually reading the story of Abraham the same way that we would. He has the Jewish Bible, like he has the Pentateuch, he has the Old Testament available to him, and he knows that story, and he's actually making kind of a commentary on the story. And we don't usually get something like this. This is someone in the New Testament talking about someone in the Old Testament. And so if you ever had the question, you said, I wish God would talk, explain more about the Old Testament. Well, this is that happening right now. This is actually Paul kind of telling us a little bit of what we can take from the story of Abraham. So let's just read Paul's commentary on the story of Abraham. Paul says this, against all hope, Abraham in hope believed, and so became the father of many nations, just as it had been said to him, so shall your offspring be. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith, and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had the power to do what he had promised. So Abraham is for us an example of faith. And when you look at Abraham's side of the story, so Abraham was in a covenant with God. We kind of touched on that earlier. So a covenant is like a legal agreement, but it's got a spiritual side to it as well. So there's more to it than just kind of if you break a covenant, you're breaking the law, you might face legal ramifications. When you talk about a covenant, if you break it, you're breaking a part of yourself. Probably the closest thing we have in our society today that you could kind of look at and call a covenant would be marriage. A Christian marriage is referred to as a covenant very often. And it's this idea, when people would make a covenant, there was always like symbolism of lives being intertwined or the reality that they would rather die than break their covenant. And so Abraham, he had this promise from God that, you know, if he would serve God, if he would follow him for all of his days, that God, he would become the father of many nations. And that doesn't sound too enticing to us today. I mean, we're not really a society that really everybody needs to have kids. You need to be the father of lots of a big family or something like that. It's not as highly valued as maybe he would have valued it, but it's even more than that for Abraham, because God said through your descendants, he would bless, through his descendants, he would bless the world. And so what God is saying to Abraham here is, Abraham, if you would be that guy, I would let you be the foundation of my work of redemption in the world. If there's one thing I know about people, is that one of the things we value more than anything is the purpose, is a feeling of destiny, of legacy. And God is offering Abraham this legacy. He's offering him something that will last forever. And Abraham jumps at the opportunity, and they enter into this covenant. And now the way they do this covenant is Abraham actually cut up a bunch of animals, and he took the pieces and he strewed them? He threw them all over the ground. And he and God represented by a lantern, they walked through these pieces. And the symbolism here was that if I break my covenant, may the same thing happen to me that happened to these animals. Now, luckily, we don't continue this tradition today. That's not how we do weddings, not even in the Pentecostal denomination. So we kind of, that's gone. But that's the significance. That's how what they thought, or how they symbolized this covenant. And Abraham did this, but God also participated in it, which is really cool. God was willing to be tied by a covenant to this mortal person, because God keeps his promises. And as we look at Abraham's story, we see that it wasn't easy for him. Okay, Abraham had to leave his home, he had to leave his family, his security. He was chased from place to place throughout his story. You know, people tried to steal his wife, his cousin almost got killed. Guys, God asked Abraham to begin the tradition of circumcision on himself as a grown man. That's a step of faith, people. Okay, you are blazing a really weird trail in life if you're doing that for the first time in history and you don't have a good reason. All right, so that it wasn't easy on Abraham all the time. And we do see, like, when we actually read his story, we see that he was human. You know, though Paul says that his faith was strong, though Paul says that, you know, he didn't give up, Abraham was faithful until the end. You know, he was faithful to God until the very end of his life. He never fell away, but he did stumble. He did have his human moments. Abraham, he slept with his wife's handmaiden called Hagar to try and kind of produce that heir, because he was 100 years old and his wife was beyond childbearing age. And, you know, have you ever been in one of those moments where, you know, God's promised something, he's going to take care of something, but you're just like, maybe if I just cheat a little, I can kind of kickstart this. You know, maybe if I take this shortcut, I could make it happen. And it usually causes more trouble than it helps. And again, this, for Abraham's family, this caused all kinds of trouble. And for Abraham, for the nation of Israel, Hagar's descendants grew into nations that were enemies of Israel throughout a lot of their history. And so this was a stumble. It was a mistake that Abraham made. And what's encouraging for us is that when we look at Abraham's story, we see that even though, you know, he did mess up from time to time, he is this amazing example of faith to us that Paul could write what he wrote about him now, in the New Testament. And we see that God doesn't need perfect faith. God doesn't need, you know, prescience, like no doubt whatsoever, just absolutely unfailing faith. What God needs is human faith. What God needs is for us to engage in this journey of overcoming our fears and our doubts. Can I see the next slide, please? Yeah, and so, as we talk about faith today, I want to kind of break it down a little bit and look at what it is. Before we go any further, I want to talk about some of the elements that I think faith requires to exist. And the first one is that faith requires two parties. Faith is a relational thing. When you have faith, there's the person who's placing the faith, and there's the person who the faith is being placed in. Faith is relational. And faith will always change the dynamic of your relationship. If you trust somebody for something and they don't show up, you know, they don't follow through, it just goes horribly, you end up in trouble, that's going to hurt your relationship with that person. If you trust in somebody and they really come through, you know, they just do a bang-up job, they put forth 110%, you're just like, wow, like that was amazing, that's going to improve your relationship with that person. When you have faith in someone, you are opening yourself up to have that relationship changed one way or another. And it's very positive when it's rewarded. That's why employers are willing to pay to have their employees go and do those, like, team building exercises, like the things where you get locked in the room and you have to work together to get out of it. I know, I've described a lot of your nightmare, lock me in a room with my coworkers until we work together. Not good. But if it works out, if your faith is rewarded, that can be very, very, very positive. It can have a really good effect on your relationship. We've all seen shows or movies where the villain and the hero, but some of you are like looking at each other and being like, I know, right? Like, we've all seen movies where the villain and the hero, by some strange twist of fate, are forced to work together to like defeat a greater foe. And halfway through this uneasy alliance, you start to see an understanding form between them. You know, you start to see they kind of like each other now. And the reason is because they're trusting each other and they're being rewarded with success. This will change the relationship that has faith. The second thing that faith requires is a test. Faith requires a challenge. It cannot be faith unless there is some reason to doubt. Okay, I don't have faith that 1 + 1 = 2. That's a mathematical fact. That's how it works. If my daughter was going to go take a test, I could study with her, I could help her, I could kind of like do a practice test or something like that. But I'd have to eventually send her to the test and have faith that she could pass on her own. Now, if I bribed her teacher, whatever the going rate for bribing a teacher is today, and I sent her into that test, I've taken the element of faith off of my daughter and I've put it on the teacher. Right? As long as the teacher does what they're supposed to do, not what they're supposed to do, as long as the teacher does what I want them to do, and passes my daughter no matter what, it doesn't matter. She could walk out of the test. She's not going to fail, right? And I can't have faith in a certainty, so I don't have faith in my daughter in that situation. You can't have faith in a certainty. And I think this is one of the hang-ups that we have with faith. I think sometimes we think that like perfect faith would be like just knowing what's going to happen. It'd be boring. You know, you'd walk through life not concerned about anything. You know, you wouldn't have any, you would never feel afraid. But I don't think faith is like knowing the future. I think faith is a little bit more like courage. Have you ever heard anybody say, courage is not the absence of fear, but it's doing what you know is right in the face of fear? Well, faith is not the absence of doubt or uncertainty or fear, but it's continuing to do what you know is right in the face of uncertainty. We look at the contrary kind of story that we read there in our verse that we just had up there a moment ago, and we see how Abraham, or he looked at the facts. You know, he faced the fact that he was as good as dead. It says that his wife was beyond childbearing age. And he faced those facts, but then it says that he strengthened his faith anyway. That he strengthened his faith. And I think one of the questions we have to tackle today is, how do you strengthen your faith? And I think the answer is pretty much the same way you strengthen anything. You know, I think sometimes we get in this thought that because faith is a mindset, we can Jedi trick ourselves into having faith, you know, that we can just sit there and like banish all faithless thoughts and we'll just increase our faith. But that's not how you improve anything. I mean, if you want to get buff, if you want to get muscle, right? You don't sit there and think muscly thoughts, right? I'm told that there's a process that you go through, okay? Apparently you do something. You go and you lift weights or whatever, and you get tough. you know, if you want to learn math, you don't just think, well, you do think math thoughts. But what you do is you have to study. You have to practice math. You don't will it to happen. You actually have to follow a teacher, right? And learn math through a process. And it's the same with faith. I mean, if you find somebody who has faith and you say, how do you have this faith? How do you exude, you know, faithfulness? They are probably not going to answer you by saying, step one, be faithful. Step two, done. Like, that's not how it works. They have probably lived their life, you know, trusting God in little things and in big things, you know, in dangerous moments and in easy times. They've trusted him over and over again and found him worthy. And it's just gotten to a point that acting faithfully is as easy as breathing. They've practiced faithfulness. I remember my daughter my eldest daughter, she had this habit for the longest time where she would read a book or watch a movie or do something, and she'd go right up to the point until there was a conflict in the story, and then she'd quit. She wouldn't want to hear any more about it. We watched The Swan Princess once, and my wife and I, we were ready because we're like, there's a dragon in the story. The princess, she gets kidnapped. It can be kind of spooky. So we're like, we're ready to jump in at those points, right? But we weren't prepared for just how much this would work. So Briar, she's watching the story, and it begins with the prince and the princess. They're betrothed, and they grow up together and get to know each other, and it comes to the wedding. And the prince and the princess are about to get married, and the prince says to the princess, you know, I love you. I want to marry you. And the prince and he says, you're beautiful. And the princess says, that's great. What else? And the prince says, what else is there? And you know, the orchestra goes like, wing! And everybody looks and stares at him because he's clearly never talked to a woman in his life, right? He's just, and the princess decides not to marry the prince. And so here's Ayla and I, you know, waiting, you know, to jump in when the dragon comes. And Briar goes, Mom, Dad, I want to turn it off. And we're like, why, honey? What's going on? She's like, they don't love each other. That was enough. Just the act of not getting married was too much conflict for my daughter. We used to joke that if she could make her own movie, it would be like people sitting in a circle telling each other how much they love each other and eating cake, roll credits. That would be it. And so we worked through this with her. We kind of had to convince her that the stories that are, like the good stories, are the ones where you're not really sure about the outcome, right? You sports fans out there, when you watch a game, you know, if your even if it's your team, if they're up by like 50 points, you know, there's no way anybody's going to catch them. Those are the games you turn off, aren't they? They're the ones where you're like, oh, I'll catch the score later, chalk another one up to victory for my team. The good games are the ones where it's close, right? The good games are the ones where it's neck and neck, and then the last possible minute somebody pulls out a victory, right? Those are the good ones. Any story worth telling has its ups and downs. Any story worth telling has its ups and downs. And guys, life is a story worth telling. Yeah, I mean, life can be hard. It can be confusing. You know, you can get kicked around a fair bit, but that's because life is an adventure. It's an adventure that can teach us that God is worth putting our trust in. It's an adventure that can teach us that God keeps his promises. I mean, Abraham could only believe in the promises of God in the context of them not being realized yet. Right? I mean, if God had just given Abraham Isaac, if he just said, Abraham, you're going to be the father of many nations, and then pop, Sarah had a baby. Right? My daughters have been pretending to have babies at our house lately. They put the doll under their shirt, and then they seem to think the next step is that pop, the baby comes out into the world. And we allow them to continue believing that for as long as they can, because this is a good time in life, and we are not ready for that talk. Right? But if God had just given Abraham and Sarah Isaac in a beam of light, for example, Abraham would have been a great example of thankfulness to us, but not a great example of faith. He wouldn't have had a chance to. We have to wait in faith on God. Can I get the next slide, please? Oh, next one. Yeah. When we read the story of Abraham, it says he strengthened his faith, and through strengthening his faith, he gave glory to God. Glory to God. Now, this word glory in the Hebrew means weight. It actually means weight. And we choose the weight that we give to God when he comes up against the problems in our lives. Okay? I remember that sticker on Ayla's Xbox. And I think back to when I read it for the first time, God keeps his promises. And I thought, you know what? He's God. Of course he's going to keep his promises. Like, to me, that seemed like too simple of an idea. It was almost trite. But as life has gone on, and I've lived more years than those, there have come days that has been really hard to remember that simple, profound truth that God keeps his promises. There have come times that I've had to stop and just remember that fact. Remember that little white sticker. Because it just seems so buried behind the fears in my life, behind the things that I'm facing, behind my own failures and my own doubts. And it's so hard to believe sometimes that the promises God has made me will come true, that the things God has asked me to do are possible. Listen, whatever you are facing today, I wholly and completely and unreservedly give you this promise that God can outweigh anything in your life. God is heavier than grief. He's heavier than loss. He's heavier than fear or pain or debt or failure or doubt. He's heavier than anything you face in your life if you will let him be. We choose the weight that we give to God when we face our problems. We have that choice every time. Do we give God the weight? Do we trust God or not? Guys, sometimes a faithful decision looks like something huge. Sometimes it's leaving everything behind and following that call that he's placed on your life and just going boldly into the unknown and following him. But sometimes faith is a small decision. Sometimes faith just looks like a little bit of temperance. You know, just not worrying about having something, denying yourself something, because you know that, you know, your joy doesn't come from that. It comes from God. Sometimes faith just looks like a bit of kindness. You know, just doing something for someone else because God's looking out for you. You don't have to fight and claw tooth and nail to get what's yours in this world, but God would rather you do something for someone else than for yourself. Sometimes faith just looks like contentment. Things aren't perfect. Things aren't going exactly the way you planned, but God is looking out for you, and you know what? You can sit back and you can enjoy the blessings he has given you for what they are, and you don't have to squirm and writhe and get angry about things not being exactly what you want, because God is looking out for you. Faith is always a choice that we have. In big things and in small things, we make that decision. We choose the weight we give to God. Guys, faith is putting our trust in a God who keeps his promises. It's not the absence of doubt, but it's choosing to do what we know is right in the face of fear and doubt. Faith is not the absence of doubt, but it's choosing to do what we know is right in the face of fear and doubt. Faith is giving weight to God when he faces our problems and choosing not to let the ups and downs of our life that are inevitably going to happen have control over who we choose to be. Faith is placing our trust in a God who keeps his promises. Will you live lives of faith with me today? Let's pray. Father God, thank you, God, for this life you've given us. Thank you, God, for this amazing adventure that each and every one of us is on. God, we know sometimes it is scary. Sometimes it is dark. Sometimes we cannot see how it's going to end. But God, in this moment, we place our faith in you. Father God, we ask that you would just help us see it through. And Lord, that we would be true to you. Lord, that in the decisions that we can make, God, we would be faithful with every ounce of our being. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Looks like the worship team is going to do a song, and while they're doing that, we're going to pass around the baskets? Yes, we're going to pass around the baskets. So there are two baskets. There's an innie and an outie. So the outie will come around, you take stuff out of it, and it's going to have a form that you can like put money in and a pen that you can write your information on. And then the innie, you put stuff in. Yeah, there we go. So you put everything back in. If you are new here today, this service was our gift to you. Do not feel obliged to give. But if you make this place your church home, please give and give generously. All right.
First in order of business, Alicia H. I guess just come up with afterwards. I think it's up here. Is it up here? Okay. Yeah, so come up afterwards. We'll give it to you. Okay. Why don't you stand and we'll do baskets and standing. We'll see how that works this time around.
Love that anyone could ever know, that overcame the cross and grave to find my soul. Until I see you face to face, and grace amazing takes me home. I'll trust in you. With all I am, I live to see your kingdom come. And in my heart, I pray you'd let your will be done. Until I see you face to face, your grace amazing takes me home. I'll trust in you. Cause I will live to love you. And I will live to bring you praise. I will live a child in awe of you. You are the voice to call the universe to be. You are the whisper in my heart that speaks to me. Until I see you face to face, your grace amazing takes me home. I trust in you. And I will live to love you, as I will live to bring you praise. I will live a child in awe of you. I will live a child's in awe of you.
Amen. You closing or what's going on here? We haven't really talked about this. Yeah, thanks for being with us this week. Been a little change. We had some people not here that are usually here. So let's just say a little word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for everything we learned this week. Help us to learn how to trust you, have faith even in the difficult times. Thank you for everything we learned that we would apply it this week and be with us. And yeah, for these things in your name. Amen. Thanks for being with us, and we will see you next week.
I don't think he's coming this way.